Welcome, everybody. Welcome to our first staff faculty workshop on professional civility in the workplace. It's my pleasure and honor to introduce Dr. Janie Harden Fritz, Associate Professor of Communication and Rhetorical Studies at Duquesne University. Janie's area of research is problematic relationships in the workplace and constructive communication practices. So she likes to say that she studies the good, the bad, and the ugly. It's a great honor to have her here today. I first met Janie at the Pennsylvania Communication Association's annual conference. I think it was in 2006. And since then, I see her regularly at conferences all around the state. So I'm really glad that she could be here today. She is a wonderful, warm, and kind person. You'll know instantly once she starts speaking. Her number one goal for us today is that we have a good time and learn something. So without further ado, I'm going to introduce her because we're on a very tight schedule, and thanks so much for being here.
Thank you, Cheryl. Thank you, Cheryl, and thanks to all of you for being here. I have some other thanks that I want to articulate. Thanks to the Andrew W. Mellon Foundation. Thanks to the Vice President for Finance, Administration, and the Office of the President. They made this possible. So thanks to them. Let's give them a thanks. And then the persons who organized this event, Meredith Goldsmith, Valerie Nelson, Missy Bryant, and Cheryl Barrett Goodman. Thanks to them. I am honored to be here to speak with you today. I'm going to go through this material. There's so much to cover. We won't get through it all, but that's okay. We'll get through the foundations, and that will give a place to start from as you go into your breakout groups. And here's the introduction. Unreflective communicative practices, moving from unreflective to reflective. What does that mean? It means that you all are already experts in communication. You talk all your lives. Well, I hope you don't talk all the time, but you've spoken, you've communicated all of your lives. All of us have. So we experience communication like a fish experiences water. We don't think about it all the time. We do think about it when something messes up. We end up in an argument when we thought we were just having a discussion. So that causes us to think about communication, to reflect on it. And that's what I hope we can do today for just a little bit. Here's an example of some of the unacknowledged assumptions that we make when we're communicating. Deborah Tannen makes this point. She says that there are those of us who know when to take a turn in conversation when the other person stops talking. So I'm communicating with you, you're speaking, and I'm waiting for you to pause so that I can start talking. And I continue to wait. And I continue to wait. And no pause ever happens. Why? Because you have been taught that if I want to turn, I'll start talking. That's when you know when to stop. Okay, so here I am waiting and waiting, and what are you doing? You're thinking, well, this person is forcing me to carry the conversational ball. I'm getting tired. Why doesn't she start talking? And I'm waiting. So, misunderstandings, unacknowledged assumptions. What we're going to talk about today, or what I will talk about with you, we will talk about together, and you will talk about in your groups, are some principles. There's not a formula for good communication. Good communication probably doesn't exist, but there are some principles of constructive communication that I hope we can cover. Otherwise, I wouldn't be here, right? So let's talk about some foundations of effective communication, beginning with language and meaning. Context is so important to communicative meaning. Context. We understand meaning through context. Now, here's part of the interactive element of this talk. Green. Somebody tell me, what does the word green mean? What's a meaning for green?
Ecologically aware.
Ecologically aware. Do you know, probably 10 or 15 years ago, nobody would have said that first, but now it's very salient. And my guess is that you're probably a green campus in some ways, in many ways. Another green.
Unexperienced.
There's another hand here, did I? Yes. The color green. Any others? Money. Yeah. And if you play golf, there's a green. Well, you've given good examples. These are all meanings of the word green, and we know what green we're referring to when there's a context. when there's a context. Context helps determine meaning, and understanding comes from shared context. This is why sometimes someone makes a joke or kids you about something, you don't know the person very well, and you take it as an insult, because you don't know what the person means. You don't know the person well enough to have context. Now, here's an example of a workplace experience where lack of shared context emerges. Don't you know, if you miss a day of work and come back, it's like, what happened? This is a different place. Gary comes in, Jean, I need the promotional stuff on the XLR copier. He's expecting for her to say, okay. But then she answers in an unexpected way. Who are you meeting with? What promotional stuff do you want? And Gary's like, I'm in the Twilight Zone. Ah, what do you mean? I didn't know I had a choice. Jean then, good work colleague, doesn't berate him for his stupidity. Instead, she says, I think maybe you missed the marketing meeting last week. I was out of the office. Ah, now we have different material for each configuration, each of these different leasing packages. Everything is new, and so Gary is, all right, now we're on the same page. All right, give me everything. I can check it out before the meeting, and if you have a moment, let's talk about which ones you think would work best with this group. Just a simple example of context that has to be created when it's missing. Contexts are interesting, aren't they? They vary from being somewhat fixed and stable to somewhat fluid and shapeable. The context we're in now is somewhat fixed in that we're all cooperating really well to let this talk continue. I'm talking, I'm continuing to hold forth, you're paying attention, you're giving me head nods, and you're not jumping up and running around and talking about other things, because you're saying, all right, let's work and make this happen. It's kind of fixed, but it's not set in stone, because without your participation and cooperation, this can't happen. So we could talk about four types of communicative competence. One is interpretive competence. In order to understand or to communicate effectively, we have to know what we're doing. See, it does work. The back button really works. What are we doing here? What are we doing together? And this takes place in all of your work days. What are you doing? Are you in a performance appraisal interview? Are you trying to interview someone for a new job? Are you just having a break with someone? What's going on? Role competence, what is your position? What am I supposed to be doing in this meeting at this time? What am I supposed to accomplish? What am I out to do? So let's say you're in a performance appraisal encounter and you're the one being evaluated and you're thinking, okay, how do I respond to these comments? What do I do? How do I respond constructively to something that I don't understand? Why are you telling me that I've not performed as I might? Or how do I thank you for pointing out the things that I could do better? We've got to understand what our goals are, what our role, what the context is, what our role is, what the goal is, and then all of those things feed into message competence. How do I respond? What do I say? And if I'm the supervisor, how do I tell you, the employee, how to improve? How do I make that message palatable and understandable? All of that is to say that communication shapes environments. What we say makes a difference. The communication we all do every day shapes the communicative environment of the place. It makes the place healthy and constructive or problematic. My guess is that you probably don't have a lot of neurotic guilt here. That is, you're looking over your shoulder. Gotcha! Oh, what do I do? Don't make a mistake. Probably it's the case, I would imagine, that you make a mistake, you learn from it. You celebrate a mistake. Here's an example from my experience that some of you may have gone through as well. We were given a gift, a financial gift, to build a new unit for our department. And the money went into the account, and the contractors came, and they measured, and they started building in the summer, and they promised it would be finished by fall. Okay. Fall got closer and closer, and that work seemed to slow down the faster the days went by. And we knew it would not be finished by the fall. And our department chair said to all of us, we know it's not going to be finished. Don't talk about the fact that it's not going to be finished. What can we do about it? Nothing. So instead, focus on your work. Teach your students. Do your research. If you have to share an office, be glad you have an office to share. And what else he said to us was, your students are looking to you for cues as to what matters. This is not a crisis. This is something that will pass. Get through it and endure it. And we did. We did. And what that suggests is that we didn't want to make a crisis out of something that wasn't a crisis. Trivialization of crisis. Everything's a problem. Oh my gosh, everything's awful. Well, then you can't recognize a real crisis when it happens, and there are real crises that happen. So what are some approaches to communication? There are some researchers in our field of communication that are convinced that every one of us has an implicit theory of communication. What is communication for? What's it all about? If you have young children, very young children, they understand the expressive design logic, but some of us, when we're adults, also express. Communication is about expressing how we feel, just letting people know we're upset or we're happy. But we can use words to be expressive as well. Here's the example. This data entry system works just fine. You're just not doing it the right way. I've showed you how to do it, but you're not following my instructions. That's expressive in a way, isn't it? Saying it's not working, it's not my fault, I told you how to do it. Then there's the conventional. We play by the rules. If you don't enter the data from the forms as they come in, they'll all pile up and you won't be able to get them entered in a timely fashion. If, then. This is kind of communicative conventionality. Nothing wrong with that. You're stating the connection of action to outcome. But what if we work rhetorically? Redefining the context. You can't see this. I'll read it for you. And by the way, I will make this available to folks so you can have copies if you want. I know it seems like saving the forms until the end of the week in order to enter the data all at once seems like a way to focus your work, but it can actually cause problems in the long run. Some of the data you're entering is time sensitive, and at this time of the year, we're making decisions several times a week. You're trying several times a day, probably. We really need that information. We can't access it on our end if it's not entered. Setting aside a little time each day to enter the new forms will really help out. That takes a long time to say. And it takes a long time to figure out how to say it, so we often don't have time for it. But in crucial conversations, and there's a book about that, it's often helpful to be able to think about what are your goals and my goals and how can we work together to accomplish some good end. Content and relationship dimensions of messages. This is one of the foundational communicative principles that, once again, you all are aware of. And when we talk about it, you go, oh yeah, I know about that. Every message has some information in it, some content. But every message also has something about the relationship that you have with the other person. When I speak to you, have you ever had somebody come up and say, congratulations? And you feel, this person is glad for me. Somebody comes up, congratulations. Okay. Same content, different relational message. Did you win that award that he wanted? Nice job. Nice job. Nice job. Close the door. Close the door. Close the door. Oh, my. All kinds of relational messages. Now, the point is, we do, all of us, sometimes give a relational message that we wish we hadn't given. And the problem with communication, is it a problem? I don't know. It's dynamic. You can't take it back. Once you've said it, it goes out and you can't remove it. So we're going to get on each other's nerves at times. We're going to have difficulties across institutional lines, right? But the truth is, we don't have to like others to work with them. Roles and restraint help us work through the content of the message and the relational elements as well. And there are times when we just have to forgive one another when we make errors and mistakes. Face. Face. Face, 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 face. There's a term, you know it, saving face. Saving face. Communication scholars and linguistic theorists argue that we all have two fundamental needs. One is the need to be connected to other people, to be respected by other people, to be considered reasonable, worthy human beings. We have another need. We have a need to be autonomous. We have a need to make our own decisions, to make our own decisions, not to be put upon by other people. We have a need for independence and for connection and for autonomy all at once, and we also have a need to have our good work recognized. Because if you buy into the idea that we are not meant to be isolated monads, but rather to work in community together, then you'll believe that that's true. That we can work independently and alone, but the things we do matter to other people. And it's helpful to hear that sometimes. So face is the public presentation of who we are. Positive face means you want to be appreciated and acknowledged. And then there's autonomy face, or some people call it negative face, but that term is so odd. Folks have reconfigured it. Autonomy face, the need to be independent. You see this happening all the time. In requests. Requests. If I want you to help me, I may come up to you and say, I know you're busy, but can you help me? When I say, I know you're busy, I'm saying, I know that you have better things to do with your time. You are not my servant. I need you. I know you're busy. It acknowledges your autonomy. Is you're willing to help me, but you want to be acknowledged, not just presumed upon or assumed upon. Or you have a real gift for organizing events. Meredith, can you help put this event together? Sure. Right. All right. That's acknowledging positive face. It's acknowledging the excellence of another person. So in both of these ways, we acknowledge others' face. And consider these two. Can you help me a moment? Versus, can't you see I need help? My dad was good at this. He'd be struggling with something, and I would be looking, and he'd go, can't you see I need help? I'm struggling here. And I'm like, oh, I didn't want to interfere. So for him, I should know to help. For me, I wasn't going to interfere unless he asked. Got to work that out. But each of these demonstrates a different kind of regard for face, or lack thereof, lack of regard. Defensiveness and supportiveness, another element of communication, which we've all experienced. We have a need to protect ourselves and our self-image. In the book, Crucial Conversations, the authors point out that in order to have a good discussion and dialogue and problem-solving session with someone, there's got to be a sense of safety. You got to make things safe. Safe to talk. It's okay to express my thought and my idea. Because if you don't feel safe, you will defend yourself, you will perhaps lash out, or you'll get silent. Silence or violence? Verbal violence, hopefully not physical violence. We're trying to protect ourselves. Defensiveness and supportiveness relates to face. Here are some examples of messages that may provoke defensiveness on the part of another person. Superiority, an implication that you are better or know better than another person. Now, sometimes that's true, isn't it? You do know better than another person. Okay, so I talk about that in my book. How do we acknowledge the fact that sometimes we do need to be told something by another person and corrected? But in other circumstances, when you are supposed to be equals, what do you know about interviewing? I've been doing this a long time. I'll take care of it. Mm-hmm. Evaluation, voicing a judgment about another person. Again, sometimes you must evaluate. We are all evaluated. We evaluate, professors evaluate students. You evaluate your coworkers sometimes, and supervisors evaluate their direct reports. And direct reports evaluate their supervisors. But this is the kind of evaluation that is problematic. It's not connected to a role. You aren't concerned about our deadline. You're just trying to get out of doing work. It's an attribution about your motives and your intentions. I can't read your mind. Certainty. Of course I'm right. There's no question about it. Control. If you don't let me head up that project team, I'll find something better to do with my time. Trying to control another person's actions. Now, the opposite of defensive communication is supportive communication. Equality as opposed to superiority, presenting ideas in a way that doesn't pull rank, minimizing status differences. Even though you're new here at work, I think you have important feedback for how we treat students. You're new to Ursinus. You've got some good ideas. Description, factual information about perceptions that may reference behaviors. You were late for work 3 times this week. Now, what's going on? As opposed to, you don't care about getting the job done. Provisionalism, tentativeness, not being absolutely sure that your way is the only way. What I've heard about this topic convinces me that this is the way to go, but I'm open to changing my mind if there is new data, as opposed to don't confuse me with the facts. And problem orientation. I have no idea what to do. We're facing a real crisis that we've never seen before. Let's work together to figure it out. I'd like for us to be able to work this out. I'm not committed to any particular solution and would like to work with you on this situation. Now, it's possible to be supportive and still ask for correction or change. We live in community with one another. We are not perfect. Our conditions are not perfect. To change things, we have to ask for change in others and in ourselves. And if you're a colleague or a supervisor, you may have such responsibilities. Support the person while trying to change the behavior. And here's an example from one of the readings that you may have had access to. A supervisor is evaluating the work of a new employee. Just like for everyone else who is new, certain errors have been occurring in your work. Now that you have a sense of what the work is like, it's a good time to try some strategies to target the types of errors that are occurring. Most people find that by devoting strategic effort, they can get the error rate down significantly. What is that doing? You're not unusual. We all make mistakes. You're new. You're not supposed to be 100% after a day. But there are errors, and we've got to fix them. Why? Because the work matters. We don't want errors in the work. We want to make sure that things are going well because we care about this place and we care about the work. And I know that you want to do well, too. So you've got a sense of how the work is. Let's try some things. Most people find that this works. We'll figure out something that'll work for you. That's supporting the person, but asking for behavioral change. And I stole this from our department chair, Ronald C. Arnett. It is his metaphor of the surgeon versus the butcher. Now, both have a place and a function, but one is not the other. So if you're trying to work in a delicate situation, you don't want to come in and start hacking away. You've got to do microsurgery. All right, surgeon versus butcher. And of course, learning, opportunities versus problems. We can fall into cliches. Some cliches actually have a grain of truth to them. Opportunities versus problems. Hope versus optimism, Christopher Lash. Optimism says, I don't see the boulder in the road. Oh, what hit me? Hope says, I see the boulder in the road. Don't like the boulder. What can we do about it? Let's work around it. Let's drill through it. Can we work together to lift it up? Hope sees the problem, but sees possibilities. And I could trot out that same example that I gave before of the response to the unfinished unit. It'll be done, and it was done. And you know what? Nobody remembers that it wasn't done. All we see is the new facility, and it's still going strong. All of these principles can also help you avoid a community of complaint. It's easy to complain. And if you listen to your first-year students, I don't know, if just like every other institution, it's the cafeteria food. Everybody comes together, oh, horrible food. It could be great food, but you gotta complain about it because that's what brings you together. I find something positive maybe could bring you together, maybe. It's easy to complain. But if you avoid a community of complaint, then you will create a positive environment, and that does not mean becoming a Pollyanna where everything is good and everything is wonderful. That's optimism, and it will ruin you, and then you will become cynical because you will have unmet high expectations and everything is bad. Okay, so easy to focus on the negative, but instead, let's see how we can make this work versus this is impossible, it cannot be done. I love my husband. He always says it cannot be done. But you know what he does? He figures a way to do it. He figures out a way to do it. His words say one thing, his practices say another. If I didn't know him well, those words would really infect me. Then we deal with the mud of everyday life. Human imperfection. Sometimes we develop thick skin. This is another unity of contraries, two things that are both true. If we are not sensitive, then we miss the unsaid. That's somewhere in this PowerPoint. I don't remember where, so you'll see it in a minute. But if we have skin that is always thin, we will be sensitive to everything that happens, and people will try to walk on eggshells around us, and that's very difficult. That creates neurotic guilt. So we need to have a kind of thick skin that we can flex. Is there such a thing? Flexible skin that is thick and thin at different times? I don't know. We could make some money if we can figure that one out. But those of us who communicate well, all of you who communicate well, and those of you who are saying, don't know if I can do this, but I think I know someone who really does a good job at this, that's what that person does. Figuring out how to let small slights pass and how to speak up and do something about issues that are truly problematic. Because you can't fight every battle. Some battles must be fought, and that's why we have laws about equal opportunity. Some problems are wicked. Others are just annoying. We forgive when it's appropriate. Now, is it ever inappropriate to forgive? I won't go there at this point. But let's say in most ordinary situations, forgiveness is helpful. Especially when someone admits a fault. Someone has slighted you, you've slighted someone, you forgive. And sometimes it's easy, sometimes it's hard. Another example from the crucial conversations, you have made a horrible faux pas. You have said something and you don't think it is forgivable at all. And one of the responses suggested is, I don't know if you're even going to be able to forgive me. You probably don't want to talk to me at all for quite some time. I hope sometime in the future you'll be able to. Most of those situations, I think, fall at the far end of our spectrum, but they do happen and they do need to be addressed in some way. Communicative style, grace, and functionality. How do we exhibit grace in our communicative dealings? But also get things done. Functionality. But when all else fails, remember the friend who comes to you when something has happened in your life that you could almost not bear. The friend doesn't have the right words. The friend has no grace of style. The friend may even say the wrong thing, but the friend is there. The friend is there. And you don't really care that the words weren't perfect because the heart is there. And that's part of the context of strong friendships and strong work relationships when you know you're working toward a common goal. So you hear the said and you hear the unsaid and you give charitable interpretations to what someone says when maybe it's not the exact perfect thing. Charitable, forgiving. I'm thinking the best of you. I'm thinking the best of you. Oh, I hope you think the best of me. It goes both ways. Simple example. You're walking on the campus and you pass someone and you give a greeting who doesn't say hello back and you think, what's with her? Well, is she mad at me? There might be another interpretation. I was walking down the street and I was looking straight at somebody and I just didn't see them and the person spoke and I woke up and I realized, oh, it's the dean of the School of Leadership and Professional Advancement, somebody I know very well. I went, oh, I'm in a zone. But if I had not woken up that moment, I hope she would have been charitable to me, and she would have said, Fritz is just thinking about her next class. Charitable. What other explanations? Now, professional civility. I've got just a few more moments to talk, and this is what I want to talk about, if you will permit me. Ordering goods in work life, and everything I talked about before, everything we have talked about together before, fits into this framework. How do we order goods in our work life? There are three major goods in this professional civility framework, and the first is productivity. It is the work itself. And it's not work that you just do because you have to do it. It is work that you do because it is in you to do it. And it's good work, and it's worthwhile work, and it makes a difference in the lives of everyone, in the lives of students, in the lives of others on the campus. It makes a difference to the world. So our focus of attention in this professional civility framework knows why we're here. It's productivity, but not productivity in terms of units counted. It is the work. It is the good work that is done. Every type of work is good work. The work matters. The second good in the professional civility framework is the place. And it's the particular. Every institution of higher education is different. It's got a particular mission. Similar in some ways, they're about the business of educating, but how the education takes place, how the work is done, is different. And I tried to look up a little bit about this marvelous school. I was here in October for a convention, and I was impressed just by the place itself, and now I'm getting to meet some of the people. Organizational cultures are unique, and here we are, here you are, at Ursinus College, and the place gives meaning to action. It gives meaning to action. There's a story here. It goes back a long way, and some of the folks are on the wall there, and they're around, and the halls are named after them, and the place itself is named after that William Bear back in the 1500s. Whoa. So there are some public guidelines here. There's a way you do things. Public guidelines. What are the parameters for this particular place? I copied this from your website. Egalitarian, unpretentious, humble, and frugal. That's why you're not Franklin and Marshall. You're Ursinus. You're not pretentious. You get things done. You know, and that background narrative of your story gives meaning to action. But you're up there in the stratosphere with those schools, and you're doing your thing your way, and you're making a difference. This is something that I have termed local hospitality, and this is what you do in your daily lives with the people you work with. I have 9 minutes. I can do this. Persons, that's the third good. The third good in the professional civility framework is persons, or people. Persons and the balance of closeness and distance. Oh, you work with people every day. You're around them all the time. And sometimes you like that. There's camaraderie. Other times you get on each other's nerves. And sometimes you're dealing with other groups. You've got staff. You've got faculty. You've got students. You've got administrators. You've got visitors to the campus. You've got all kinds of Middle States accreditation people. Oh, everything. So how do you work with each other in a way that provides enough distance so that you can move freely, but also connects you, because you do have that common project. And that's what I argue in this professional civility framework, that it is the work itself and the place itself that connects you as persons together in the workplace. Now, with a spouse or a significant other or a very close friend who may not be in the workplace, the relationship itself can be enough. But in the workplace, you've got to build a relationship on something other than your feelings for another person, because if you've ever experienced a difficulty in a relationship that used to be good at work and then went a little bit bad, you know how difficult that can be, because you still have to work together. So how do you balance? Public and private life. Now, that doesn't mean you're not going to make friends with people at work. It's going to happen. Some of you may be best friends with each other, and you have figured out how to put on different hats. Today, I'm my role of colleague hat, because we're working together with other people who do not know us. And if we make inside jokes with each other and wink and nudge, they're going to be excluded. That's going to be exclusion, ostracism, and cliques. Oh, don't want that. But you don't want to give up the fact that you enjoy working with another person. So you figure it out by context. What are we doing here together? We're on a project team. Do we know the other people? No. All right, let's treat each other as work colleagues and not as best friends. There's not time to show you the little scenario from To Sir With Love. Watch that, the Sidney Poitier version. Here's this engineer turned teacher. He's in the classroom with these students. The students are out of control. And one day he loses it. And then he realizes these students are going to go into the world of work. They're not kids anymore. We've got to help them function in a better way. He walks into the classroom, and the first thing he does is say, "We're going to talk to each other, you and I. We're going to take turns talking. When I talk, you will listen without interruption. And when you talk, everyone will listen without interruption. The young women will be addressed as Miss, and the young men will be known by their surnames." And one of the students says, "Why should we call them Miss, sir? We know them." And he says, "Is there any one of these young ladies that you think does not deserve to be called Miss?" And he goes, "Oh, no, sir." Sir was asking for a kind of distance Yes, they knew each other, but function for a moment with a little bit of the distance of respect so people can move. Martin Buber says that good relationships start with distance. Distance, because you can't see someone when they're right in your face. You can see them when they're just a little farther away. Now, if they're too far away, you can't see them either. A good balance. So organizations as public spaces can function with this balance between distance and task intimacy that creates solid teams, shoulder to shoulder, not always face to face. So roles and public dignity, you all have a place to fill, and that role gives you dignity. It doesn't matter who you are. It matters who you are in the organization. Now, of course, you matter as a human being. If you didn't matter as a human being, President Fong would not have supported this event. But the roles matter because the institution matters. So restraint and expression. When do you hold your tongue? And then when do you speak the good word or sometimes the word of correction? Work friendships. I already went over that. Good. I can zip through it. The dangers of cliques, working with friends within roles when in public task groups, and the example was inside jokes. When you have inside jokes with another person, when other people who do not know you are present, that creates a sense of exclusion and can be somewhat problematic. And finally, know the value of private life. Have a rich outside life so that if things aren't going well at work, you have a place to retreat. Now, sometimes we're in a situation where nothing is going right in private or public life, and then you just have to tread water. Tread water until something changes. And then finally, public hospitality. It's not really finally, but it's going to be finally because we're about to the breakout sessions. But we've covered enough, I think, to give you something to think about. Invitation and welcome. The local hospitality was working with each other, maybe in your offices, in your groups, in your units. But public hospitality, welcoming those from the outside, either outside in terms of your unit in other places on campus, or maybe people from literally the outside of Ursinus. Embracing service, which you all do. You serve in a noble way. Even on a bad day, the mission matters. The purpose is there. We all serve. Faculty serve. Administrators serve. Staff serve. The students learn to serve, even when they're being served. And even on a bad day, it won't last forever. It will pass. It doesn't feel good at the time. So communication with students and coworkers and faculty, we do assertiveness and responsiveness. By assertiveness, I mean openness, welcome. If I were to walk down here and come close, not too close, if I came too close, you would rightly cringe, but an openness to contact. I'm looking at you. I'm oriented towards you. But then there's responsiveness. Now, how can I do this without turning my back? There, I didn't fall. That's good. Your openness, you're open to contact, you're willing to work with others, and you're responsive to others. You're discerning priorities. If you've ever watched someone as you begin to talk and the person's countenance falls, or the person looks confused and you're able to say something different or try another tactic, that's responsiveness. Professional civility and working with others in the workplace takes both openness and welcome and a responsiveness to another person, and also knowing when to back off. And of course, expectations have to be clear as well, and you work those out with each other on a day-to-day basis. You figure it out. Okay, I think I will stop there. I'm going to stop there because I think it is 9:40. How close am I to my guess? 9:39. Okay, good. That gives you a minute. I believe the next unit of this workshop is for facilitators, and thank you, facilitators, for facilitating. If you would come down front, facilitators, we're going to have facilitators come down and line up across the front, and each facilitator will have a room, sign, and number, and to make this work, we need your help. All righty. It looks like everybody's back who's coming back. I hope you had a productive and interesting time in your groups and hope you had a little fun too. In the time that remains, I would like to give all the groups, there were, I believe, 7 or 8, an opportunity to report back on what you learned or some of the things that you think are valuable to share with the rest of the group as a whole. And I expect the best way to do it would be to go ahead and have each group one at a time just go ahead and give everything they've got. And we hope we'll get through them all. One way would have been to go around and do all the negatives and all the positives and all the things, but we'll just go one at a time. So I don't know there we go. We've got a volunteer. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Molly Cherson from the Mission Office. I don't know if we should stand by.
That's perfect.
I'm going to kind of scoot over here so I can get as many people in. Our group was absolutely fantastic, great group of ladies, and I wanted to go first because we didn't quite follow the rules, and so...
That's right. Creative chaos.
So, we really spent a lot of time reflecting on your presentation, talking about personal experiences. Two major things that I thought were kind of highlighted throughout our conversation was one, kind of the transition to technology.
Oh my.
And communicating via email. We didn't come up with any solutions, so I'm sorry I can't give everyone that. But really just thinking about how did our conversation transition, can it transition, and how do we utilize that via email? And then the one thing that we actually spent a lot of time on that I really enjoyed is that no matter if you're faculty or staff, you're continually interacting with our students that are going to be on campus very soon. And what does this conversation mean in teaching civility and teaching communication? And we gave some really great answers about being empathetic and finding the problem in the solution. And maybe I think sometimes we kind of get into the tendency of every student might, you know, be the same when they come and present a problem to you, but really trying to find out why exactly they're standing in front of you and what does that mean in context. And then we had a little fun sharing time about thinking about some really positive communications that we've had or that we really appreciate. And so we spend some time talking about the people that we appreciate that communicate with us very well and giving examples there. So
it's good.
Sorry
to
we didn't follow all the rules. But I still think we're very productive and I personally really enjoyed our conversation.
That's wonderful. Thank you. I'd like the issue of serving. Yes, let us. Yay! So many things stand out there. The issue of the particular. Here's a student with a presenting problem, but it's a unique moment, and the context does matter. Wow. Thank you. What's another volunteer from the group? There we go.
We actually kind of followed the script a little bit, but there was a lot to come from for that. As far as the good scenarios, we found that when you have conflict, a lot of times asking for clarification of what the person needs and verifying that you're aiming towards the right purpose clears up a lot of confusion. And so obviously it goes right back to communication. also agreeing to collaborate on problem solving if you're running into problems with a person or with people, you need to agree to get together and try and come to the root of the problem. And as much as everything is by email and a lot of people think email is not the way to solve problems, sometimes the distance offered gives you time to write an email 40 or 50 times before you feel like you've gotten it right and gives you that distance from the emotional. So if you need to get something across without losing it a little bit, email can be a good solution. The main thing that we ran into with the bad scenarios are people that are unwilling to compromise on issues. Or they can't put aside personality differences and focus on the common goal. That their needs and wants are more important than what the goal is.
That's the challenge, isn't it? Trying to find some way to establish, like you said, a common purpose. And if both people are willing, then it can work. And sometimes it takes the person who is willing time to establish a safe environment so the other person may gradually come to that perspective. It's not easy. Yes.
Well, I don't know about the other facilitators, but I had the best group. And it was a nice mix of faculty and staff from a lot of different areas on campus. And one of the, I tried to follow the rules. and it worked in the beginning. We focused on good outcomes and bad outcomes, and then we got back together and sort of had a large group discussion. One of the important things about when we reflected on good outcomes is how important early intervention is. Early on, recognizing that there is a problem and taking action, somebody mentioned in our group how important it is to have a good mentor, and how helpful that can be in growing in your work and as you're growing, you're hopefully more open to be open-minded to other outlooks. The opposite, the bad outcomes, a lot of them result in people either quitting or leaving, asking or being nudged to leave. So that stressed to us even more how important it is to recognize a problem early and take action, and how important it is to look at ourselves and recognize our own involvement in a problem or in a solution.
One of the things you pointed to also emerges in the book that deals with crucial conversations, and that first principle is look in the mirror and ask ourselves, what role do I play here? How may I be contributing? And people who are willing to do that often become much stronger in terms of being willing and able to participate in helpful ways, but finding out, it takes a lot of honesty, and it's sometimes painful, but you do it. Thank you. Another group, another representative, back there.
So we had our positive and negative scenarios. For the negative ones, the commonality with email is misunderstanding, misread tones, which you can't find, you know, through a personal conversation, lack of empathy. Email sometimes distances the sender, which can be positive or negative, depending on, as someone said earlier, that, you know, people may not be comfortable with making that initial face-to-face conversation. And as you talked about earlier with face, saving face, face is threatened, which invokes defensiveness oftentimes. Some of the good things that we came about with our conversations were that emails, often people recognize that they need to move from an email conversation to a face-to-face conversation because they can sense that it's not being received well. This is positive and constructive, and email becomes more comfortable for some after that initial face-to-face conversation is made. Misunderstandings can happen in a face-to-face conversation as well, but you also have the addition of facial cues, which can help, which you lose in an email conversation. So we decided to make a plan to make it better, openly communicate immediately before problems escalate, before forwarding an email and beginning to copy supervisors, which really can be problematic sometimes.
That's a big one. Very true. You point out many, many, many good things, as everybody has, in terms of the nonverbal, because that's a big part of that relational message, isn't it? And something that just occurred to me as you were speaking is that the face-to-face and the email and the phone, all our modalities of communication work together to create context that may then help interpret whenever a message comes that we might take the wrong way. We think back and we say, I don't think she meant it that way. And then she makes a call. Hey, sorry about that. You know, let me explain. Very, very good.
Our group was mainly facilities and campus safety, but I remember someone saying to me that if you ever find a conflict-free group, filled with all nice people, stay away from it because you'll ruin it. So I think something about us people, we don't bring a perfect thing to any group, and no group could offer a perfect thing to us. So in that sense, this is kind of humbling, but it's a good humiliation because we kind of can get on a level that's more workable, because I think if you set the bar too high for yourself or other people, you may be prone to just being resentful your entire life.
Now, also in our discussion, I know we were talking about this whole conflict thing, and it's so important that when someone offends you, that you address that. You don't just let it go on and try. I mean, I'm the kind of guy, I could bury things and just not deal with it. But that just ends up festering inside of you. So it really is important to deal with it. Either go to the person, and there's usually a miscommunication there. Something wasn't communicated right, or they didn't understand what you meant. So, but to just hold it in and not deal with it and just let it fester is just not good. So.
Many good things there as well. One of the things that strikes me, that y'all may have heard too, is that when you do deal with whatever issues may arise, you get better at it. You get practiced at it. How do we resolve that issue? And how do we make it work? Going into it with the assumption and intention that we can make this work. I know we both want to make this work helps a lot. And the issue of coming into a group, we're not perfect people. Wouldn't you rather have the B person who makes the group an A than the A person who makes the group a D? Whoa. So there's so much wisdom here. This is great. We can wrap it up and sell it. It's good. Yes. And then we'll.
So our group actually came up with a number of the same things. So I'm just going to vote for some of these things. We talked about various difficult scenarios and solutions to them. One was when you have a conflict with someone in a public setting, it's often good to help that person save face, let it go, and address it privately afterwards, if that works. We talked about what do you do with a colleague who has a temper, and address it right away, nip it in the bud. Humor often diffuses a situation, but then move on. You know, have a thick skin. Once you've addressed something, then move on. If a problem is persistent, we sort of went to that. You have sort of two options. You can go to that person's superior, but also it's mostly better if you have a persistent problem with them to learn to keep a civil but professional distance. We talked about one scenario that a person was having a difficulty and was told by their superior just to deal with it, and they felt that made the situation worse. So we concluded that superiors need to help their subordinates find strategies to deal with the situation rather than just say, deal with it or deal with that person. We talked about the email issue and found that sometimes email is useful to follow up on a conversation to kind of get it in writing, or to even just end a conversation saying, well, let's summarize what we talked about. Because often people leave conversations thinking they've been promised this or told that. And so it's sometimes good to summarize, and email can be a useful follow-up. A final thing we talked about was a source of difficulty, especially in a time of transition, as we've been in, is not understanding the context in terms of sort of chain of command and who has what responsibilities. And we found that information is really essential, that contextual information. Especially if you're asking someone to implement a change involving technology, for example, a little explanation of why it's necessary can go a long way in creating willingness to do that. But we also concluded that we want to ask Kelly Williams to publicize a flowchart of the chain of command on campus, because a lot of us don't know who, where to find that. So,
thank you. The why for the how. what is that? I think Viktor Frankl quoted Nietzsche saying, you can bear any how if you have a why. It helps. And the other thing is focus of attention. Once you deal with an issue, you move on. Because if you keep looking at it, your hand can become as big as the sky, and it's not. And you move on, and then the event becomes part of the larger picture, and you can get something done.
Apologies to my group for glossing over lots of important insights. Tori ably mentored our group. I have five do's and don'ts. So do be professional, even in the face of bad news, disappointments, to try and ride that out can make the situation turn around in the long run. Do use humor. Do prefer face-to-face communication, especially when you're dealing with difficult or detailed situations. Do help students learn how to use the email. As one person in our group pointed out, they're used to social media rather than the email and may need instructions, especially how to deal with certain groups of people. Do sweeten your messages with a personal touch. What doesn't help and the don'ts, people have a tendency to feel threatened, and when they do feel threatened, this makes it harder for them to communicate well. Don't bypass the people responsible and appeal immediately to a higher authority to try and control the situation rather than working things out with others. Don't make presumptions instead of getting information first. Don't be as direct or blunt, easily construed as being rude in your communication. Or if you have a tendency to have that speaking style, explain that that is your approach.
Just like to tell it like it is.
And finally, don't succumb to the tyranny of the urgent.
Oh, the tyranny of the urgent. Excellent. Long haul matters. Very nice. Oh, these are wonderful. Is there? Yes. That's a good point about discerning the context, knowing when certain things really must be done and when they don't have to be. And you also point to something important. We are emotional creatures, and we do respond, but we do have the ability, we know from the emotional intelligence literature that was popularized by Daniel Goleman, that it is possible for us to take a step back from our situation, especially when someone comes to us and either accuses us or brings a problem to us, something about ourselves, to be able to listen first and to get a little distance. That's hard. That's the first step, and then you can come to an understanding, perhaps. Have we got all the groups yet? Oh, my. Yes, thank you.
So I'll just hit some highlights since most of these have been covered already. But what came out as positive attributes was humility and letting go of the ego, which is a constant struggle for everyone that I know of. Recognizing that each person has different responsibilities and you all have a common goal, and not allowing the conflict to disrupt what your responsibilities are, and being upfront and overly communicative so that assumptions aren't made about your actions or what you will, what your intentions are, and to accept responsibility and a willingness to apologize for your actions. And lastly, recognize that no one can read minds. And then things that don't contribute to positive environments are personal, not job-related attacks. It's easy. We recognized in our group that situations would happen work-related and very quickly devolve into areas of personal opinion or outside of life. Overly defensiveness on the part of either person in this relationship, and not taking the time to do things right or properly, trusting the judgment of others when you know that you should probably just double check things anyway. Casting blame and allowing fear to and other emotions to ramp up and escalate situations. Not respecting others' abilities and expertise. And not explaining the why, just saying, because I said so, doesn't work very well. And when you're tired or there's lots of pressure, job-related or personal life pressures, they tend to escalate these situations.
The common goal and the common task, that really makes a difference, doesn't it? When you all know you're working for something worthwhile, then you can, that becomes the why for your how, especially if you have a mission for an institution like this one that supports it in every way. Any other groups? That's all. Are there questions or comments for the good of the order in the next 6 minutes? Anything that maybe wasn't covered that you would maybe like to hear another minute's more on, or some anything that occurred to you at any time this morning that you think would be, oh, okay, you were screaming, yes.
You know, I think we were a little, I was a little leery of this whole procedure today, even being one of the facilitators. I actually found it very valuable. It was really nice hearing from people in other departments and knowing that the same kind of issues were across campus, and that we're all still trying to make this the place we want to come to, and that just, for me, validated the whole shebang.
How about that? What am I? Yay!
I want to concur and thank you, but I just, one thing that concerns me a little bit is only one of the comments seemed to pertain to students. And I sometimes wonder whether we spend a lot of time being civil with each other, but we don't extend that civility to students. Mm-hmm. And sometimes I hear horror stories about students about the you know, treatment they get from this faculty member, that staff member, and you know, you always have to take it with a grain of salt. But I think we need to remember that our students are also our colleagues in the mission of this college, and we really need to be as civil to them as we are to each other.
That's true. And that's a good about perceptions as well, because they're young, aren't they?
And they're infuriated.
And they're yes, yes. And you help them mature as they learn to work through those kinds of issues. Yeah. That's also an important point to think about. We consider the entire unit, and then you hope those students come back years later and they go, oh, you know, I was upset about that, but it helped me grow, or thank you for helping me. That was a real problem, and you helped it. Anything else? Any other? Well, got a hand. Thank you. You have to send up a flare. Right. Thank you.
Well, I guess this sort of backs onto what Maureen said in that I was a little concerned because sometimes discussions of civility, I think sometimes there's a stereotype that civility means silence or civility means not saying things. And I was struck that in our group, we kept coming back to again and again, say more, communicate more, right? Communicate more and more with each other. That's the way. And I think that's a really positive thing, that we were civil to each other by actually communicating more, not less.
That also resonates with that crucial conversation book. Put lots into that pool of dialogue and information. Put it in there, because if the information's not there and the insights aren't there, you don't have anything to draw from. And that takes a sense of safety, which I think you all have here. Thank you for letting me be here. Thank you for your work. Thank you to everybody. Thank you.